The World Wide Web, the Internet, a cesspit, infinite entertainment, an information superhighway. No matter what you want to call this invention that you're using to watch this video, it's an integral part of our lives by this point. In fact, it's hard to imagine using a computer without using the Internet. These days it just feels kind of empty. You boot up your shiny gaming beast computer with the latest and greatest operating system from your favorite big tech megacorporation, and it's just empty. You can't really do much on your computer without the internet. Music has evolved from vinyl to CDs to streaming, you can't buy PC games physically anymore, and even single player games require a constant connection these days to ensure you're the rightful owner of the game you're trying to play.
Back in my day, you just inserted the floppy disk in the slot and launched the darn game! You kids and your stupid online technologies.
Okay, cynical old man that I refuse to call by his generation's nickname. But his point does stand. There was a brief period of time where your family might have had a computer, but no internet connection. What did we even do back then? I want to explore that era of computing as someone who experienced it only as a kid for a very short period of time. I'm Chris Carlos, I like computers, and today we're taking a trip to the past and going offline. So you've got your not so shiny and not so new Windows 98 computer and you want to have some fun. Even without an internet connection, there's plenty to see in cyberspace, all within the comfort of your own hard drive and other removable storage media.
I feel like playing some games. Well, I don't have anything installed yet. Let's just see what games and toys came with my operating system. Ah yes, the good old pre-installed Windows games. While nowadays Microsoft includes a few crappy mobile games with microtransactions in their flagship operating system, back in the day when computer games were a selling point, they included some simple games that became legendary due to how addictive they were. Or maybe people were just more easily impressed at the time. Solitaire, Minesweeper, Hearts, and FreeCell were included with Windows 95 and 98. Honorable mention to 3D Pinball Space Cadet, the most legendary of them all, which shipped later with NT 4.0, 2000, and ME. Sadly, it's not a part of this video. Shoo, go away. These pre-installed games, my favorite of which was Solitaire, were the greatest time wasters of their time. I mean, you've got some amazing new technology right in front of you, you might as well use it, even if it's just to waste time. And suddenly, before you know it, you've spent an hour on Minesweeper.
And of course, this wouldn't be a retro Windows video without mentioning Microsoft Paint. The cultural impact this program has had cannot be overstated. Just look at it, instantly recognizable and cozy. It was originally called PC Paintbrush, released by ZSoft in 1984, but Microsoft quickly snatched it up and started packaging it with MS-DOS 4.0 in 1985 to show off the capabilities of a mouse. Besides the pre-installed games, there were plenty of very popular commercial computer games at the time being sold on store shelves in the form of floppy disks and later CDs. Myst, Roller Coaster Tycoon, Baldur's Gate, SimCity 2000, which ironically came out in 1993 and not 2000, Lemmings, and Worms, just to name a few. But one of my favorites that I want to highlight is the Incredible Machine.
Imagine a Rube Goldberg machine in your computer!
Welcome to The Incredible Machine. It's a physics-based puzzle game published by Sierra Online in 1993, spawning a much more improved sequel in 1994 after seeing runaway success. The point of the game, as with many games of this era, is not narrative whatsoever. It's more toy-like in nature. The footage you're seeing here is actually from The Incredible Machine 2, but the original game is very similar, albeit a little less impressive graphically. In this game, you place household objects on the screen so that when you start the physics simulation, you achieve the goal of the puzzle. Sounds simple in concept, but programming this must have been a nightmare. So many simulations, so much going on, and it all had to run on single-core 286 processors of the time, the fastest of which could run its clock at up to 25 megahertz. That's right, megahertz. Just to give you some perspective, the computer I'm editing this video on, 30 years after the release of this game, can run its clock at up to 4.2 gigahertz. That's 168 times faster than the fastest processor this game was targeting at the time of its release. And they were running physics simulations on that thing. As if the hard-coded physics weren't enough, you can actually manipulate the force of gravity and pressure in this game in the sandbox mode, which allows you to create your own puzzles and mess with the laws of nature however you wish. This is simply incredible. When I was getting footage for this game, I kind of forgot I was recording and ended up playing it for like half an hour. I find it really addictive, and it was really cool to revisit this part of my childhood.
Well, that game was really fun, but I don't feel like I learned anything, and you know, that just isn't productive enough for me. What if I could play and learn at the same time? What if there were games that taught you things? Oh my gosh, I'm a genius. I should pitch this to... Oh, it's a whole industry called edutainment? All right, whatever. I didn't want to take credit for the idea anyway. Edutainment, the best way to learn in the age of information. No more boring books or lectures. Now you get to learn while having fun on your personal computer. Software in this category ranged from video games with just a little bit of educational material in them to poorly disguised encyclopedia that pretends to be a game sometimes. And I love all of them. Getting educated while having fun has evolved a lot since then, and it feels like education and entertainment have been largely disconnected. But if there's a direct continuation of the spirit of edutainment in our current day and age, it's definitely Brilliant, whose sponsorship made this video possible.
Brilliant combines fun with learning, just like the days of old, with its very intuitive and rewarding system that encourages you to learn a little bit every day, whether you're in the comfort of your gamer cave or out on that walk you remember to go on once a month. It's got courses in all sorts of disciplines like math, data analysis, programming, AI, or even just basic science. If, for example, you want to learn about why the physics of the incredible machine work, you can take the Physics of the Everyday lesson. The way Brilliant teaches you these concepts not only helps you dunk on your roommate by yapping about why you didn't have to call a plumber after all, but it also builds real-life problem-solving skills in that noggin of yours, making sure you're actually learning instead of just memorizing. What I really like about Brilliant is that it doesn't punish you for your mistakes. It simply explains why the correct answer is correct based on what you've been taught previously, and it doesn't shame you for not knowing. For me, this is critical, as I don't really do well with the type of teacher that's like, I've said it once, so you should know it. Brilliant can just explain to you over and over what you need to know until you've learned it at your own pace. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/kalos or scan the QR code on the screen. Or if you're old school, like the topics of this video, click the hyperlink in the description. Oh, I almost forgot to mention, you'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. Alright, back to the past.
Some of my favorite edutainment games came from Dorling Kindersley, more commonly known as DK Multimedia, who published some really fascinating educational games in the 90s to go along with their educational books. The ones I want to highlight specifically are My First Amazing World Explorer and My Amazing Human Body, both of which were translated and published in my mysterious European country as cereal box games. Thus, I got to experience them as a kid, and honestly, I wish everyone did.
Although the game named My First Amazing World Explorer came out in 1996, I've actually played the 1998 sequel called My First Amazing World Explorer 2.0, which is what I want to revisit. Something about the way the world is presented in this game is just so whimsical. I got to learn about different continents and countries through this piece of software, even if it was very rudimental and stereotypical knowledge. The audio design is just so charming. You get to navigate an interactive map of Earth, and as you hover from country to country, the music shifts to reflect what country you're looking at.
East. East.
As a kid, this was so satisfying to me. Point being, not only did I have fun, but I also learned.
So obviously, now that I'd conquered the world, it was time to conquer something smaller, something more familiar. The human body! No matter what you do, the title of this game is awkward. My Amazing Human Body? But I didn't let that deter me as a kid because I wanted to learn. And oh boy, did I learn.
Before this game, I didn't know there were different hair types, or that the liver is officially called ipar in Greek. The pre-rendered crude CGI cutscenes, if I can even call them that, are such a staple for this era of games, and they're everywhere in this one. Just look at him go! Chris, did you just include this game because of the pre-rendered cutscenes? Yes, Chris. Yes, I did. We can move on now.
Stop! Enough fun and games. Time for some serious learning. No fun allowed here. Oh, shiny pictures and videos.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, the precursor to Wikipedia, Encarta. What I'm showing off here is Encarta 98, and oh my god, this piece of software is so nostalgic, even though I never even used it as a kid.
Now, some of you kids might not know this, but before all the information in the world was on Wikipedia, we used to buy and refer to physical books called encyclopedias, which were, well, just that. Books with facts and knowledge. Encarta was a very popular digital encyclopedia, published by Microsoft themselves.
I find it really fascinating how much they've been able to achieve with the limited technology they were working with. Look at that, it's like Google Maps Street View in 1998! There is so much charm here. I really wish computer interfaces weren't so boring these days. Can I just say, the vectorization of computer graphics was a mistake. Look at this beautiful pixel art. Seriously, I feel like that's part of why computers these days feel soulless. The graphics are too perfect. I wonder if my favorite tech YouTuber extraordinaire, Carlos Likes Computers, will ever make a video about UI. I guess I should subscribe and turn on notifications, just in case he does. There's a surprising amount of information packed in this program, and many articles that the developers anticipated would be popular have really cool visual material to go along with them. There are videos, images, animations, audio, graphs, panoramas, and so on. I don't know what it is about Encarta that makes me feel like I'm not just learning about the world, but uncovering some hidden knowledge that few have the privilege of feasting their eyes upon. But that's how it makes me feel. Like the world is a wonderful place. Like life is beautiful.
Let's capture some of that beauty with this old camcorder. This is a Sony Hi8 cassette camcorder. Although it's a little newer, having been released in 2002 instead of the late 90s, it's still the best I've got in terms of home video technology of the era. We've actually been using it to shoot parts of this video. Wait, so how is it here? Back then, it was just a camcorder, a computer, and a dream. You often needed convoluted setups to adequately digitize the tapes from these camcorders unless you had one that recorded straight to digital. Then, once you had your precious footage on your electronic computer, you would crudely edit it with state-of-the-art software of the time, something like MGI Video Wave or ULEED Video Studio, after which point you would burn it to DVD or VHS to show your friends and family and crack up at the novelty of the whole thing. Here's a hilarious home video! That was hilarious! Absolute knee slapper! We should send that into America's Funniest Home Videos!
Wait, do they even take submissions from Europe? That's right! Before internet video sharing platforms were popular, there was an entire TV show dedicated to covering funny videos recorded and sent in by regular people. It's still going to this day, but it's lost its charm in my opinion because the novelty of seeing people's everyday lives on TV has faded, having been replaced by people broadcasting themselves on the internet. I used to watch AFB a lot as a kid in the late 2000s in my unknown to you but definitely real European country. It seems a TV network here bought the rights and ran episodes from the 90s for us Europlebs to watch a decade later and lament about how un-American our lives are.
If all that thinking and pondering led you down the dark path of derealization and dissociation from reality, and you felt like expressing your creative urges in a digital form rather than seeking beauty in the mundane life you found yourself in, Microsoft had you covered with 3D Movie Maker.
It's kind of crazy to me that they made a 3D Movie Maker in 1995 before they made a real-life Movie Maker in 2000, but I digress. Microsoft 3D Movie Maker is a program/game/sandbox thing that allows you to make beautifully rendered professional-grade animations to send along with your job application to Pixar. At least if by beautifully rendered you mean extremely low resolution, and by professional grade you mean 15 frames per second. Despite its limitations, or maybe because of them, Microsoft 3D Movie Maker had a moment on YouTube in the early days due to the sheer absurdity it enables you to depict.
My favorite 3DMM creator, VillainWins.mid, has videos on their channel made in 3D Movie Maker that have more views than this video you're watching right now ever will. But hey, if you want to help me get at least a tenth of the way there, drop a like.
It's been open sourced by Microsoft and reborn in the form of 3D Movie Maker Forever, a project that aims to make 3DMM compatible with modern hardware.
All this reminiscing was really fun. Alas, we must get back to present day. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this little self-indulgent nostalgia trip and learned a thing or two about what life was like before the internet. This video was inspired by the Virtua EP by Trendy Trendy, which is also where most of the background music you've heard so far comes from. If you want to be transported to this era of computing in musical form, give it a listen. I'm Chris Collis, I like computers, and I'll see you next time.